worship this morning. Hear our hearts as we lift up our praise to you and exalt you to your rightful place.
Fairest Lord Jesus, ruler of all nature, thou, O God, and man the Son, we will I cherish, thee will I honor, thou my soul's glory, joy, and crown. Brightest star in heaven, Jesus, you're everything to me. Oh, Jesus, you're everything to me. You are fairer than the fairest of 10,000. Lovelier than all I've ever seen. You are brighter than the brightest star in heaven. Jesus, you're everything to me. Oh, Jesus, you're everything to me. Beautiful Savior, Lord of all nations, Son of God and Son.
The glory and the praise. He is the Lion of Judah, and he's the Lamb of God. He has taken away our sins. He bore them on a cross. And now he reigns for all eternity. We're going to give him glory this morning. Let's sing this out. Above every name, and every chain will break as broken hearts declare his praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Lift us up. Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before him. Slain for the sin of the world, his blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before him. Oh, oh, oh. So open up the gates, make way before the King of Kings. The God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He is roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before him.
No one compares to your glory and to your might, Lord. No one compares to you.
Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? No one. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Oh, who can stop the Lord Almighty? There is no stop the Lord Almighty. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Oh, who can stop the Lord?
Come on, here we go.
Our God is the Lion. Roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before him.
Celebrate our God this morning. Yes. He is the Lion and the Lamb. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. He is our strength and our joy in every battle.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer.
rises, we wait upon the Lord.
Come on. That's it. Isaiah 40 says, have you not known, have you not heard, the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth, neither faints nor is weary, nor understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the weak and to those who have no might. He increases strength. Even the youth shall faint, and the weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. He is the everlasting God. We rise on his strength and his power. Let's wait on him this morning. Sing this out together.
You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God, the everlasting God, the everlasting.
You are the
pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are the God of all joy. And God, no matter what circumstance we find ourselves in, God, we thank you that you are bigger than our circumstance, that you can work in the midst of difficulty, in the midst of imperfect people. Your perfect plan can be realized. And so, God, today it is our prayer that we participate with you, that we walk with you and experience the joy of keeping in step with your Spirit. God, we thank you today for each person that is here and for the blessings of each moment. We thank you that Olivia Atkins and Katie McCann were able to successfully have their babies. And now we pray for them and for their families that you will give them strength for this next season. And God, today we lift up our own. We pray for Jim Smith. And God, we thank you for his faithful ministry here. And now we ask you to intervene, to give him strength and healing for his body. We pray for those in our community who may be physically well but spiritually sick. God, we pray that you would fill us with courage to share the gospel with them, that we would see people in this place because of our obedience to share our faith with others. And God, we pray that you would not close our hearts up, that you would give us hearts of compassion, not just to share your gospel, but to share your love with those who are around us. God, reveal to us those in need of ministry. And God, give us the eyes to see and the opportunity to fulfill that ministry, to do good in our life to those who are around us. Be with us today. Holy Spirit of God, teach us from your word. May we leave today more obedient to you. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
I hope you know that we have a God who can do anything. Maybe you've experienced that in your life. But we want to share this testimony this morning. Eventually, we want to teach it to you as a declaration that we have a powerful God.
Just one word, you calm the storm that surrounds me. Just one word, the darkness has to retreat. Oh, just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. And just one word, you heal what's broken inside. Just one word, and you revive every dream. Just one touch, I feel the power of heaven. And just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. Oh, there's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a prison wall He can't break through. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do.
God, You've done it before, and You will do it again.
I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like His power. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our Jesus can't do. Oh, there's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a prison wall He can't break through. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's nothing. Oh, there's nothing. Oh, 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 oh. There's nothing that our God can't do.
Well, last week we began a series that reorients us toward joy. My appeal to you today is Christian joy is full of emotions that allows us to be deeply satisfied in God Himself and satisfied in what God can do in this world through our lives. The difference between Christian joy and the happiness, the temporary happiness that the world has to offer, is not in the emotion that is given, but in the path that we go down. The path to Christian joy is not one that is intuitively traveled. We do not discover these paths of joy unless the Bible reveals them to us. But once the path to Christian joy is discovered, it can be walked daily, and then we can possess a joy that is not rooted in a circumstance, but is rooted in the God who is bigger than all circumstances. We put this idea out last week, and part of a good series is we need to learn a little every week and repeat a little so that we learn it all by the time the series is over. But joy is not as easy as finding people in good situations, because there are plenty of people who are in situations that, if we're honest, we might be envious of. We wish we had their life. But even though they are in a better situation, it seems their emotions of joy is low. It may not even be present at all. Sometimes in life, people who apparently have great situations are in very poor emotional states, and those who have poor situations are in great emotional states. And this is one of the difficulties of life. It reminds us that real joy is not rooted in a circumstance, but must be rooted in something else, because good people in good circumstances don't have joy. A lot of people think I need another circumstance to be joyful. And in my experience of watching joyless people trying to find joy in a circumstance, they move from one situation to the next, from one relationship to the next, all in the pursuit of joy, only to get temporary relief and then to be maybe worse than where they started. They say, man, I've done all this moving. I've changed out the people in my life. It made me happy for a moment, and now I am unhappy again. What if I told you today you could travel to joy without leaving your seat? That you could be right where you are, the situation could remain unchanged, but joy could be found not in a new situation, but in a new orientation. And the Bible says if we could understand and see the world as God sees it, if we could root ourselves in God and in His plan, we could have joy bigger than our circumstance, which is the key message of this series. So if you have a Bible, if not, it'll all be on the screen, Philippians 1, 12 through 26, where we will see that changing circumstances, even bad ones, can propel God's plan, and we can participate in that plan and find joy. So here's the first big idea, three big ideas coming at you today out of these verses. We can have joy bigger than our circumstance when we understand how God is using our circumstance to advance not our comfort, but His plan. Sometimes circumstances do advance our comfort, but not always. Look at verse 12 through 14. The Apostle Paul says these words, "Now I want you to know, brothers, what has happened to me has actually resulted in the advancement of the gospel, so that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to everyone else that my imprisonment is for Christ. Most of the brothers in the Lord have gained confidence from my imprisonment and dare even more to speak the message fearlessly." So we're going to have to wrestle with some ideas, because we don't like it when our circumstances change, because even though when we say joy is bigger than circumstances, we still like our circumstances to be so-so. Pretty much all of us, I would assume, in the room. So we can say as a Christian, God is in control. But even though God is in control, it certainly does not mean that our life on occasion doesn't feel out of control. So God is in control, but I feel out of control. We ought to be real careful with our language here as well, because sometimes when we say, you know, God can work through your circumstance, that is heard by some to diminish the difficulty of your circumstance. I have sat with people who have been the recipient of untold horrors in their life. Life has really dealt them a bad hand. Their pain is real. Their difficulties are real. So never when I say God can work in spite of your circumstance, that is in no way to diminish your circumstance. Because if we live long enough, we're going to get kicked squarely in the face at least a few times. There is evil in the world, and all of us to some degree will be touched by it. So we can say God is in control, life is hard, situations are painful, but what we can say as well is, while not diminishing what happens to us, we can still say God works in spite of it. So we can say, God, I've legitimately been hurt in my life. Circumstances have not been what I want them to be, but I can see how you're still moving in spite of it. You know, I think about the Apostle Paul in our text today. There's a background I gave last week. I won't give the whole background again today, but simply put, Paul's in prison. And he's not there in prison because he's done anything wrong but be a Christian. And his imprisonment was difficult. Even the events leading up to his imprisonment. The Apostle Paul spent several years on mission. He traveled around the ancient world sharing the gospel from Jerusalem now all the way to Rome. And if you have a map out, that's a lot of space. It's not a small territory that he's covered. So Paul is completing his third missionary trip. He comes back to Jerusalem. In Jerusalem, they grab him. They arrest him. And then they put him on a ship and say, you need to be tried, not in the local courts. We want you to go to the big court in Rome. So they put him on a ship, not much of a ship, a prisoner ship. A storm kicks up. Even on his way to be imprisoned in Rome, he's shipwrecked. I've only been out on the sea a few times. But when storms come up at sea and you can't see anything but water, it's terrifying. Because you know you're a cork in the water and you are at the will of the sea. Well, the worst happens to Paul there. The sea takes his ship and crashes it on an island that you can look up on a map, the island of Malta, which is off the coast of Rome. And so you can imagine the trauma of a shipwreck. Maybe you can't. I don't really want to even know the trauma of a shipwreck. I'd like to miss that one in my life, if possible. And so he crawls on this island to try to recover from the shipwreck. And guess what happens to him while he's on the island? As he's walking to get his bearings, a snake bites him. This is all in the Bible, by the way. It's all found in the book of Acts. And it's one of these snakes. It's not the black snake that so many Virginians love. You know, keep the black snakes around. They eat mice and things. No, this is one of the snakes where when they bite you, they don't even call a doctor. They just go. They wait for you to go into anaphylactic shock and die. It's one of those snakes. And so, nevertheless, when Paul gets bitten on Malta, the natives just go, sorry, bud. You know, you survived the shipwreck. Now you're going down with venom. And God miraculously spares him from that. And then he finally winds up in a prison right outside the Roman Forum. Now, this makes me want to ask a series of questions. Why did God allow all this to happen to the Apostle Paul? You ready for my answer? I don't know. Each one of those things. Was all of this necessary to fulfill God's plan? Potentially, but I don't know. But what I do know is cumulatively, I can't say out of every bad thing, here's something good that's come out of it. And anybody who tells you they can do that in their life is overly simplifying things. But what Paul can say cumulatively is this, and he says it in verse 12. Now I want you to know, brothers, what has happened to me has actually resulted in the advancement of the gospel. And so this is the cumulative effect of all of these bad things has gotten Paul to a destination that he wanted to get to all the time, and that was Rome. See, oftentimes when bad things happen to people, this is the reason their joy leaves. They say, God, how can you allow this to happen to me? There's no way I can be joyful. Look at all this bad stuff. I've been imprisoned on false causes. I've been snake bitten. You've let me to be traumatized at the sea. God, too many bad things have happened to me. I have lost my joy. And so if that's the perspective that you take, you clearly will have lost your joy. Another truth I put out last week, I put out again, is that Christian joy is going to be found, firstly, in seeing that while the evil that happens to us, we can't make sense of all of it, but we can believe God is still working in spite of it. And then when bad things happen and when we find ourselves in difficult situations, we cannot just be focused on the bad that has been done to us. When we find ourselves in a situation and say, well, God, you've put me here, if we would stop focusing on the bad that is done to us and refocus to the good now that could be done through us, we'd have joy. And Paul basically concludes this: I'm in Rome. There are lost people in Rome. I've always wanted to share the gospel in Rome, so I might as well share the gospel to the people who are around me. And he says, right here in the Bible, that the whole imperial guard, all the security guards who are making sure that he stays tight, he's sharing the gospel with them. You see, this is a joy that is bigger than circumstance. And quite frankly, in life, we have to learn to embrace this. I made this point a few times, but I just want to make it one more time just to make sure we grab it today. Good and evil are real in the world. There is good, there is evil, but it is hard in life to see the entire picture. And I think if we are based in situational joy, you go, you know, I didn't have a good morning. I'm mad. I had a good afternoon. I'm happy. I had a bad evening. I'm mad. I had a good night. I'm happy. You understand? Bing, 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 bing. This is the way some people live. It's horrible. I mean, it's joyless. Because even when you're happy, you're just waiting for something to tick you off so you can be mad again. And so I want to kind of pan out. I am saying there is good. I am saying there is evil. But in life, it is so hard in the moment to see the bigger picture. Let me give you some examples. For example, let's say a person really needs a job. They don't have a car. And so a good Samaritan says, I'll pick you up for your job interview. And so the morning comes, the person oversleeps, misses his ride. Good or bad? You say, bad. Now I'm upset. But that the good Samaritan who was going to pick them up on the way to where he was going crashes the car. So it was good or bad that he missed the ride. See, life is complicated. A lot of different ways you could answer that question. Or here's a good example. Another example, say a person gets in a car and they have an accident. You say, well, that's bad. They get hauled up to the hospital. But while they're at the hospital, the doctors, while checking them over from the accident, find another condition that would have not be symptomatic that actually might save their life. So was it good or bad that they got in the crash? It's a tough question to answer. Or you say a person makes a really bad business deal. They lose all of their money. They lose their business. So that's bad. But in losing everything that they have, they release the self-sufficiency that they've had for many years, repent, and really get right with God. So is it good or bad that they lost their money? It's tough to figure that out. Or you say, well, let's say a person who's in deep financial woes gets a lot of money. You say, that's good. Except they have no idea how to utilize all this money. They never had money. And then all of a sudden, all their friends show up, and they need money now too. And the person becomes terribly depressed and maybe is even pushed towards self-harm because they don't know what to do under all of this stress. Life is not as simple as evaluating it circumstance to circumstance. And I'm not saying this is true in every situation. But I am saying it's true in some situations. Sometimes God does allow evil to come for a greater good to be produced. Like exactly how was Paul going to get to Rome if the Romans hadn't paid for it? A free cruise ship right to Rome, not the one he wanted. You say, are you sure that God allows evil sometimes to produce something greater? Well, sure I am. The cross. I mean, God allows the evil of humanity to be poured out on Jesus, and yet out of this moment of great evil, a greater good of the redemption of all humanity is the result of God allowing an evil. What am I trying to say? You're not even in a situation to fully evaluate your circumstance, and if you basically say, my circumstance is bad, therefore I am unhappy, you just don't know the full sweep of things, of what God is doing and how God is moving in spite of a lot of factors. Does that mean that bad does not happen? No. But does it mean that God can work in spite of it? Yes. And in hindsight, would you see that even though this was painful, God was working? Yes. And so this completely defeats the idea, if my circumstance is thus and such, I can be happy, because you don't even know what thus and such it needs to be to ultimately accomplish what God might be up to. The virtue of humility can go a long way in our life. You say, not only are circumstances bad, you know what else upsets me? Not me, just you, all of us. People who are mean-spirited, they mess up my life. Well, guess what? Paul has the same problem. Notice the second big idea. We can have joy bigger than our circumstance when we believe God's plan moves forward with less than ideal people. Notice here, Paul not only gets a bad place, he's got bad people around him. It says, some, to be sure, preach Christ out of envy and strife. That is not why you're supposed to preach Jesus, because you're envious and you're strife-filled. But others out of goodwill. These do so out of love, knowing that I am appointed for the defense of the gospel. The others proclaim Christ out of rivalry, not sincerely, seeking to cause me trouble in my imprisonment. What does it matter? Just in every way, whether out of false motives or true, Christ is proclaimed. Here's the theme of the letter again. And in this I rejoice. Yes, and I will rejoice, because I know this will lead to my deliverance through your prayers and help from the Spirit of Jesus Christ. Something we ought to be thinking about carefully. When bad things happen to people, I can promise you that none of us have the full picture. And it is true in the first century as in the 21st century and even in the BC era. And the AD era, when bad things happen, it seems there's this natural impulse in our hearts to try to make sense of it. And the book of Job, an Old Testament book, of all the truths that it gives us this one main truth. When bad things happen to people, the best thing to do is show up. I want to be gracious here. Be quiet. You get the other word I'm thinking. Show up. Be quiet and grieve with people. You don't know why this has happened. And if you become a friend, like Job had friends, and you try to interpret their plight, likely God will have strong words for you after you finish saying what you are saying. But guess what? The people who should have read the book of Job didn't, even these ministers of the gospel, and they took this occasion to tell Paul why he should have done things differently so he didn't get in prison. I've been in situations where ministers have done the best they could in a church, and things have gone poorly. And when things go poorly, all the experts show up. They start saying, well, you know, if I was the pastor of this church, you know, they do a lot with their pants, you know. So I'm like, what's wrong with your pants? You know, stop pulling on your pants, you know. I guess it just shows they're too big for their pants. Sometimes their pants are too big for them, but nevertheless. And they always say they come in, they've got all these ideas. Well, that's exactly what's happening to Paul. And I can tell you, that's a tough wound. You know, it's one thing if people on the outside throw rocks at you, but your own who should... I mean, these ministers ought to be the ministers of encouragement, not the ministers of rivalry. You know, sometimes this could have really rattled Paul's head. Now, I try to think, in this day and time, when people say negative things to you in this culture, what do? Fire back. Don't you let them get away with anything. If they said something negative, you need to set the record straight. They call it Christian virtue now, it seems. It's not a virtue at all, by the way. A soft answer turns away wrath. That's what the Bible says. So Paul doesn't punch back at all here. Paul looks at these ministers. By the way, Paul in other letters has strong words for ministers who minister out of false motives. But Paul says God's going to deal with them. In this situation, Paul's able to look at these guys and go, goodness, gentlemen, is this the level of maturity that we're at? That you're going to take this occasion to beat on me? But you know what Paul says? Well, at least you got your gospel right. Okay? You're pretty mean, but at least you're saying the right words. So you know what? I'm going to rejoice in that. That God can use as imperfect of a person as you to still accomplish his plan. There's an old saying about preachers that God can draw a straight line with a crooked stick. And in so many ways, this is exactly what's happening here. Is God's Paul saying, man, you guys are a mess, and yet the same perspective Paul looks at his circumstance, he looks at people around him and says, God can work in spite of that. Do you believe that? Do you believe that the people in your life who seek to do you harm, God's able to work his plan around them? And that if you participate with God, remember, joy is not found in our situation, but our participation with God. And if God can maneuver around our circumstance and maneuver around people, and you're participating in it, you can be joyful. Because God's going to win in the end. And if you don't possess that, you'll probably be pretty bitter about a lot of negative stuff that has happened in your life and a lot of negative people that are doing it. You say, sometimes I ask God, I say, God, why did you give the church so many duds? You know, we want all stars, and sometimes you give us duds. And you know what I think God says to me in those situations? He says, because sometimes I just want the church to know that I'm doing it. And that when the church looks around and sees all the stuff that has happened over 2,000 years of church history, and the church is still here, and the gospel is still proclaimed, God says, I'm the one doing this. Because you can tell all of these guys couldn't have actually pulled that off. Here's my big idea, and we conclude. The last one. We can have joy bigger than our circumstance when our main objective is Christ is honored in our life and in our death. Verse 20 says, my eager expectation and hope is that I will not be ashamed about anything, but that now as always, with all boldness, Christ will be highly honored in my body, whether by life or by death. For me, living is Christ and dying is gain. Now, if I live on in the flesh, this means fruitful work for me, but I don't know which I should choose. I am pressured by both. I have the desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better, but to remain in the flesh is more necessary for you. Since I am persuaded of this, I know that I will remain and continue with all of you for your advancement and joy in the faith, so that because of me, your confidence may grow in Christ Jesus when I come to you again. I'll just point out this, that we must move from situational comfort being our main objective to this. Whatever circumstance I'm in, can Christ be honored in this circumstance? And there is no circumstance, no matter how good or bad, that Christ cannot be honored. By the way, Christ can be honored when you're in a good circumstance. You could be on top of the world. You could be at the apex of your career. And in that moment, guess what? You could honor God in a big way. You could be in rock bottom. And in that moment, you could honor God. Paul says, I find joy in participating with God because in any situation, I want Christ to be honored in my life. And can I just tell you, there is a real joy in participating with God and keeping in step with God no matter your circumstance. You know I keep saying in this series that joy is greater than your circumstance. Maybe this is too much to throw at you at the end of the message, but I'll throw it at you anyway. If you can get the right orientation in any circumstance, you can actually have, you know, joy in the situation. So it's, you know, it's joy greater than circumstance, but it's also joy in the circumstance if you can see it different. Like Paul's in a Roman prison, not a good place to be. But he's saying, I'm participating with God, so his joy is full. And quite frankly, the worst thing that could happen to us this side of eternity is death. That's bad. Unless living is Christ and dying is gain. Paul's idea is this, participating with Christ in this moment, experiencing his joy, and even if the worst happens, death, greater joy to see Christ face to face. You know, church, I ask you the question today, how is your joy? I'm giving you a lot to think about. How is your joy? You say, Rusty, my joy is not good today because my life is not the way I want it to be. Well, let's do some mind renewal. Why don't you realize that joy is not found in your situation, but in the degree to which you are participating with God in this moment? You say, but Rusty, you don't know all the bad stuff that's happened to me in my life, and there's no way I can be joyful with all this bad stuff. Well, realize that God is able to move through difficult life events to accomplish his plan despite the bad that has happened. You say, but Rusty, no, I'm still ticked off because all these people around me, they are so mean-spirited. Realize then that in spite of people and their poor character, God is able to move in spite of them. You say, but Rusty, there's so much bad that's been done to me. And I said, well, and I would say, realize that the sooner you stop dwelling on the bad done to you and start focusing on the good that can be done through you, you will actually be able to participate in God's joy. You say, but Rusty, what if they do the worst? I said, if they do the worst and death comes, which is probably not on the horizon for many of us, that living is Christ and dying is gain. Yeah. Amen. Amen. And so I would challenge you today. See, you can stay right where you are and not change your situation, but change your orientation, and the joy of God is available to you. Are you a Christian? To have joy, you have to have a relationship with the God of all joy. You say, Rusty, how do I become a Christian? You admit that you need God. You say, God, I am a sinner. And you tell God, I put my faith and trust in you. I trust you, Jesus. And if you do that, you become a Christian. In just a moment, during our time of invitation, I'll be right here at the front. I'll take a Bible and show you how you can be a Christian. But you say, Rusty, I am a Christian. Well, you know what? One of the things that God does for us is that He provides us virtues. They're labeled in the Bible the fruit of the Spirit. And you know what one of the things that God gives? He says He gives love, and guess what's second on the list? Joy. And if you today will just reach out and take it, the God of heaven will give it to you. Church, we cannot wait around for circumstances to be the way we want them to be to experience joy. The Christian can experience joy outside and inside of every circumstance if we can be connected to the very God who gives it. Let's do it. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we ask you, God, fill us with joy. God, we cannot experience this joy unless you do it in our hearts. So we admit our need for you to fill us with your joy. God, we've been experiencing changing circumstances here for a year going on two. And God, we'd like things to be different than they are from a human perspective. We would like the evils of the world to slow down. We'd like people to act better. And yet in the midst of all of that, we realize that you're a God who's bigger than all of this. Your plan is still moving forward, and we can join you. So God, help us to grab on to what you're doing. God, may we entrust to you the bad that has been done to us. And now may we take every opportunity in a world of confusion to let good be done through us. And God, as we participate with you, even in difficulty, God, help us to experience your joy. We thank you that you do this. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand together as we make this decision to follow Christ in our circumstances.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. All your ways are good. All your ways are sure. I will trust in you alone. Higher than my sight, high above my life. I will trust in you alone, in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. In this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you. Oh. Light into the world, light into my life. I will live for you alone. You're the one I seek, knowing I will find all I need in you alone, in you alone. Stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. In this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you. Life everlasting, in you there's
is freedom for my soul. In you there's joy, unending joy. And I will follow. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. In this life I lose, I will follow you. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. In this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you. Home.
Amen. Let's make that decision right now that we will change our orientation within our situation and see God give us joy in that. Have a great day. God bless you.
In regard to your Christian commitment, please let us know. We would love to see you in person, if at all possible, so please join us. Our mission here at Liberty Baptist Church is working together to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the glory of God. Come be a part of our family. See you next Sunday. God bless you.